I'd like to greet you all in the name of Jesus as we are continuing with our series on leadership but studying the life of a great man called David. I believe that anyone or most of you know exactly who David is, David in the Bible and his achievement and what he has done. But before we go into that, I want us to pray for the nation of South Africa. They are wearing the flag of South Africa because I wanted us to come before the Lord and pray for this nation. We all know what we are going through as a nation. We all understand the challenges for the coronavirus in our nation. So I want you to keep the nation in prayer. We are having a prayer every day at 6 o'clock in the evening to pray for the nation. The prayer started on the 27th of the month of March. It will continue with us until the 14th of June for a period of 80 days. We'll be praying every day at 6 o'clock. So I encourage you to join us to pray with us and as we intercede and call upon the Lord for the nation of South Africa. And obviously praying for Africa and the rest of the world. So today I want you to lift up South Africa before the Lord. We have been favored by God that He allowed us to go through this season that divinely protected our people. So I want us to pray and bring South Africa before the Lord, the nation that He loves. Heavenly Father, in the name that is above every other name, the name of Jesus, we call on your name, my Father and my God. You said, call unto me in the days of trouble, and I will answer and reveal unto you hidden treasures and mysteries of heaven. We call on your name as the nation of South Africa, that you, God, will not forget our covenant with you, that you will not walk away from us, but you will be with us. You will manifest your glory to us. You will show us your goodness, your grace, and your mercy. So we ask you, Lord, to intervene, heal our nation. You said in your word, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves, seek my ways, repent from their wicked ways, then will I hear their prayers and heal their land. We ask you to heal our land physically, heal our land economically, heal our land socially, heal our land in all aspects. We ask you to heal South Africa. Touch your people, heal politicians, heal business people, heal pastors. Heal the corporate people, heal the laborers, heal everyone in the nation. Let the people have an encounter with you. I pray that in this season where people are grieving and confusion is upon the nation, I pray that there will be a divine encounter. Let your spirit roam around street by street, city by city, province by province, touching the lives of people. We call unto your name that South Africa will never be the same. Thank you, Lord, for what you're doing. Reveal your hand, reveal your might upon this nation. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. So I want us right now, as we are going on with the word of the Lord, talking about the life of a man called David. But generally, our theme for the year is leadership. We are looking at the life of David as we are talking about leadership. I spoke first about David being a leader. And I mentioned a number of things about David being a leader. And I'll take off from the very same platform I laid before. Remember, I mentioned that leaders are not usually chosen by people. People don't usually see anything in them, but God sees something in them. So we are going to go through 1 Samuel 16 from verse 8 to verse 23. I will not go through the reading of all the scriptures, as you can see in all, it's about 16 verses. But I will try to quote and read some of them so that you can have an understanding. But I encourage you that you go back home, open your Bible, read those 16 verses so that you can understand what I'm talking about. There is nothing that transforms your life more than the reading of the word. If you become a Christian who hears the word when the preacher is preaching on Sunday, you will miss the blessing of the Lord that he has for you. Become like the church of Berea, that went and researched everything that Paul and the other apostles spoke by researching the word of God. Whatever I preach, I encourage people to check it with the word of God. The nation is deceived. The nation gets into trouble because people don't study the word on their own. They depend on the pastor, which means if the pastor lies to them, they are all deceived. If the pastor leads them astray, they are all going astray. So I'm encouraging you right now that you will be able to go and read the Bible yourself. As I said, 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 8 to verse 23. We have read verse 1 to verse 7 where we see that David is standing, or Samuel is standing before Jesse. looking for a son who can be a king. And Jesse brings all his sons, but he forgets David. And in verse 7, he brings Eliab, who is his eldest. And when Samuel saw him, he said, "Surely this is the Lord's anointed." And God said to him, "No, I don't see as man sees, because man looks at the outward appearance, I look at the heart." And I still want to repeat right now, if God is going to choose you, if you're going to be God's candidate, what will matter the most? It will be your heart. It will not be your gifting. It will not be your degrees. It will not be your connection or anything. It is the heart. The heart of a man is very much important. The heart of a man can take you far in life. So God looks at the heart. After that, the Bible says he brought the second son called Abinadab. And the prophet looked at him and said, no, this is not the one. Up to the seventh one. And when they were done up to the seventh one, the prophet said to Jesse, "Jesse, are these all your sons? Are these all your sons? I see you've brought them all. But are these all your sons?" That is in verse 10. He says, "Jesse had seven of his sons pass before Samuel. But Samuel said to him, 'The Lord had not chosen this.'" So he asked Jesse, "Are these all the sons you have?" And then Jesse remembered. He said, "There is still the youngest. He is tending the sheep." Samuel said, "Send for him. We will not sit down until he arrives." Now imagine, the father did not even think. So when Jesse did not even think, brought all his sons, the prophet said, "Are these all your sons? Is this all you have?" And that is only when Jesse remembered, "Oh, I have another one. His name is called David." And he said, "Okay, there's another one." I want you to know that there are situations in your life where people will forget you, situations will forget you, everything will forget you, but God will pause, will force people and push people to remember you. God will make people to remember you. They had forgotten about David. They never considered David. They never brought David. But God made sure, "This David that you don't consider, I will bring him into the picture." So they brought David. So, and the prophet said something powerful. He said, "Call for him. I will not sit down until he arrives." Imagine, the great prophet Samuel says, "The way I want to see this boy, the way I feel, I cannot be relaxed until he arrives. I pray the Lord will make people uneasy. People will not relax until they give you what is due to you. I pray God will make people not to have peace until they give you what is due to you." God made the prophet Samuel not to have peace until he sees David. There are people God will remove their peace until they give you what is due to you. You don't have to go and toy and fight and push things and, you know, argue with people for whatever that is yours to come to pass. Stay in your will. Stay in the will of the Lord. Stay in your lane. Fulfill what God is saying. God will take away people's peace. There are people who will not sleep at night until they give you what is due to you. Samuel was not going to relax, sit down and enjoy life until they called for David. And he said to them, "Go and call him. Go and call him." And definitely when they went to call him, they were thinking, this man, we don't think that even this David will mean anything special. But they went and called for David. And someone said, "I'm not sitting down. I'm not relaxing. I'm not getting to a point of comfort until this one that we did not call comes." And when they asked Jesse, he said, "Well, he's basically tending the sheep. He's doing the lowest job ever, tending the sheep. So there is no way he can be a king. But well, anyway, since you are the prophet and you are the one who wants him, we will go and call for him." And the Bible says they went and called for David to bring him. I want to make you aware that someone in this place is probably a David. Somebody's listening to me. Somebody is watching me and is a David. When they call people, they didn't call you. And then they still did not believe you are the candidate. They still did not believe you need to be called. You are doing the lowest job ever. Nobody thinks about you. But God is not a man. He doesn't see as man sees. He doesn't do things the way man does it. He doesn't fulfill things the way man does it. He does things in his special way. I want you to know this very day, you are not subject to man's choice. God is not democratic. He doesn't make people to vote for you. He doesn't need people's okay for him to appoint you. He doesn't need anybody to embrace you for him to choose you. He chooses you irregardless. He skips everybody's judgment, desire, and protocol to bring you to a place of destiny. That's how God operates. I want to speak to someone in here who is saying, I am not educated. I didn't go to school. I am not smart. I don't dress good. I don't look great. Yes, God, when he appoints, he neglects what people use as credit in order for them to embrace you. God looks at what he decides and says, this is the one I want. And I believe when they went to look for David, because he's spending time with the sheep, he didn't smell good. He did not dress good. Nobody becomes a shepherd wearing a shoe and a suit. Nobody becomes a shepherd with a nice smelling perfume. Nobody becomes a shepherd with an expensive belt. Everybody, the shepherd, dresses the lowest, doesn't smell good, lives an ordinary life. But can you imagine in the meeting of the great seven brothers, different profession, different achievements, comes a boy from the field, smelling sheep, smelling the bush, to be appointed in their midst. God is going to make you be appointed in the midst of the great. He will not remove the great and appoint you. No. He will appoint you while the great are watching. He will embarrass the wisdom of the earth to fulfill what he says in his way. He will embarrass the great of the earth to manifest what he wants to do as God. When he wants to do something great, he does not even consult anybody. That's why he's called God. It means self-sustaining one, which means he holds no meeting with anybody to fulfill anything. He consults no one to do what he wants to do. He needs nobody's approval to appoint you to your destiny. So I want you to know, the people who know you, the people who discredit you, the people who look down on you, the people who push you away, they will never be in God's boardroom when he decides to elevate you. He will elevate you without their permission, without their desires. He will just elevate you. So the seven brothers of David, according to them, this was an insult. For David to be lifted up in their presence was an insult. But God did that. He lifted him in their presence. The prophet said, I will not find peace until he comes. There are people who will not find peace until you get that position. There are people who will not find peace until you live in that house. There are people who will not find peace until your ministry grows the way it's supposed to grow. There are people who will not find peace until all the things that God told you comes to pass. God will make sure people will not find peace until they fulfill what he said. And the Bible says when they brought David arrived. Samuel did not see the king. It is the Lord who spoke to him. He said, arise. He is the one. Arise and anoint him, for he is the one. There was no way with the eyes of man Samuel would see a king in David. The eyes of man discredited him. The eyes of man did not even see anything special in him. So when God does something, he does not consider the eyes of man. I know there are eyes of men that are around you. There are eyes of men that are not seeing anything special about you. There are eyes of men that are going to push you away. But God is going to tell those in authority to say, arise, he is the one. Arise, anoint him, appoint him, place him in a place of rulership and position. Leadership needs people who will keep doing small things until the right time. The problem with many people who want to become leaders is that they place themselves in high position before the right time. If you place yourself in high position before the right time, you won't make it. David could have easily decided to join the great seven. David could have easily decided to be with his brother, but he did not. He embraced the small work of being a shepherd. to some people in a church, God has given you ushering. God has given you cleaning toilets. God has given you taking chairs. God has given you parking. God has given you small work in the church. You are not impressed because it looks so small, you don't want to do it. God, when he is going to visit you, he will go exactly to the position you are in and pull you from there. You know, one day I was in the hospital and I saw a doctor going to different beds and he would pull out a file. There were no patients there. He would read the file and he would leave medication. Pull out the file, read the file and leave medication. And I asked the nurse, I said, but why is the doctor doing this? He said, no, based on the file, the doctor can give prescription. And I started thinking, what if the patient comes back and chooses not to go to his bed? It will mean he will get a wrong prescription. And immediately the Lord spoke to me. He said to me, I always go to the place where you're supposed to be and pull you from there. Can you imagine if God is expecting you to be in parking in order to pull you to greatness and he doesn't find you in parking because for you parking is small? Can you imagine if God is expecting you to be in cleaning toilets and he's sending his angel in the toilet to elevate you and he doesn't find you in the toilet? Can you imagine when you've missed your mark because you want something great and you miss what God wants to do in your life? So I challenge you this day. David remained in being a shepherd. God found him in shepherding. Had he walked away from shepherding, he would have missed God. He would have missed his anointing. And again, he would have missed becoming a king. So I challenge you to become exactly what God has intended about your life. David did that and saw the hand of the Lord upon his life. So the Bible says they went and looked for David, brought him. And when they brought him, the Bible says, God spoke to Samuel. Samuel used to anoint people using jars. He would use clay jars and all these things to anoint people. But at that time, God said, don't use any of this. Use a ram's horn. Pour oil in it. Why? Because a clay jar and all the things that Saul, Samuel used before, they were made by men, which means he poured the anointing in a man-made thing. But when it came to the time of David, God said, I don't want you to use a man-made object to carry the anointing. I want you to use a God-made object to carry the anointing. A ram's horn is made by God. A ram comes from creation. So God that day gave David a special anointing coming from a ram's horn. And he anointed him for kingship. He did not anoint him for anything. He anointed him for kingship. Anointed him to be a king. And when he anointed him, his brothers were in shock. This simple guy is getting anointed. Now let me tell you something that can shock many people. After his anointing to be a king, he never went to the palace. He never even on the way to where the king is. He never even looked for the king's address. He never even tried to start building himself to where the king. From the anointing of being a king, he went back to be a shepherd. That's where people miss it. They think immediately they receive the anointing, they receive a connection with someone, they should leave doing what they've been doing all along. They don't know God can anoint you and take you back to Asher. God can anoint you, take you back to be a parking attendant. God can raise you, take you back to the receptionist. God can raise you, put you in the same position, waiting for the right time, because the anointing, when it's in you, anointing attracts trouble to build your heart. Anointing attracts opposition to make you stronger. Anointing brings things in your life so that your faith can rise, so that when the time comes for you to fulfill what you're supposed to do, everything you're supposed to experience in your life, you have experienced it. So most people miss it right there. I am anointed, so I can't be doing this. I am anointed, so I cannot be serving in the church like this. I carry the anointing in my life. David saw the anointing come upon him through a ram's horn. He went back to do what God wants him to do. So I challenge you today, all anointed men and women that are not yet at the time of what God wants to do in their life, understand the times and season. Understand what God wants to do in your life. Don't rush ahead of time. Follow the time. Understand that certain things will come as time goes on. They will not come right now.
The anointing is there. The power is in your life. The revelation is there. The fire, you can feel it. But not, maybe not the timing. You need to wait for the timing of God and do exactly what God wants you to do at the right time. I carried a certain anointing. I grew up in a church called Africa Evangelical Church. And I knew the anointing upon my life. But I waited for the right time. I waited for the right time. And when the right time came, things became very easy. Somebody, you are anointed to be a millionaire. And maybe it's not the time. You need to grow. You need to learn. You need to read books. You need to encounter things. You need to learn that. You need to serve there until the right time comes. Because if you raise your head before time, the devil will kill you. And somebody is anointed to be a prophet. But maybe you should be serving for some time before the right time comes. A lot of things. Someone, you're anointed to be a great politician. But don't raise your head before the right time. Wait for the time. The anointing must not deceive you. The anointing must not come upon you to confuse you. But the anointing must come to be able to fulfill things at the right time. Now, I wanted to understand this. When David was anointed, he knew that the anointing of the Lord is upon his life. God has filled his life. He's able to do a lot of things. And the Bible says, a man called Saul, who was the king at that time, he was attacked. He had a spirit or a demon manifesting in him. The Bible says, at that time, the king looked for someone who could remove what he was feeling. And the Bible says, he said, send for a man who can help me. People looked for David. They called him with a harp. He came into the palace, not to serve the king or to be learning kingship, but to come and worship. Now, sometimes God is raising you for this, but uses that as a stepping stone. He's raising you for kingship in a normal sense. In a normal sense right now, if somebody's supposed to be a king, probably he's supposed to be a chief before. He's supposed to be a prince before. He's supposed to go up the ranks step by step until he becomes a king. But God sometimes doesn't work like that. He took David from being a shepherd boy, to become a musician, a psalmist, from a psalmist to the throne. He never took him through the processes of kingship. Now, sometimes God has his own processes for you, but you are going to create man-made processes for your life. And when you create man-made processes for your life, then you end up missing what God has intended for your life. Now, when that was done, David went to play a harp for Saul. And the Bible says, and when he played a harp for Saul, the spirit that tormented him left him. Why was it like that? Because David was anointed. The anointing upon his life is the one that drove the spirit that traumatized Saul. And Saul fell in love with David. And that's where David learned a lot of things about kingship. He did not come to learn about kingship. He came to serve through the gift of a psalmist. A lot of people, you are going to learn about your destiny, but you will not be invited to come for your destiny. You'll be invited for something different. But as you walk in the path of learning, then you will learn about your destiny. You will step into your destiny. So I challenge you this very day. I challenge you this very day as you're watching, as you're listening, that you must understand the processes of God. Every leader who's going to make it in the world, in life, must understand their processes of God's process, God's ways, God's thinking is totally different from men. If God did things like men, if God planned like men, if God processed things like men, everybody would have experienced what God has intended for him. But because God wants us to depend on him, to walk in his ways, to take our time, to understand him, he has his own ways of doing things. David had to understand, it's not yet time for me to win rulership. It's not yet time to take over. It's not yet time to be the great king. I have to serve this king. I have to fulfill what I am supposed to do. And he continued being the son of Jesse, serving in the house of the king, waiting for the right time. And I believe David didn't go around telling people, you guys don't know who I am. I'm going to be the next king. He didn't go around telling people, I'm about to be a king. He did not go around. If it was in today's terms, he would not be putting on Instagram or Facebook or everywhere and say king in the making. He would not be doing all these things that people are doing today when God has spoken to them. But he would remain a simple, humble man, knowing that what God has said about me will come to pass. I need nobody's approval. I need nobody's engagement. I need nobody's embracing. But I must just fulfill what God said I should do. And in due time, he will fulfill his word. A lot of people right now, because they've been anointed for something, they're carrying the title. Because they've been anointed for something, they're already into it. Someone, God has spoken to you. You are going to be a millionaire. And that's what you're telling yourself. You're putting that on everywhere, telling everyone. You don't know that the people that God is raising to be great in life hide themselves. Hide themselves. Hide their destiny. They never go around disclosing to everybody and showing everybody who they will become. But they become simple, ordinary. And in due time, God raises them. God specializes with surprises. To surprise people and bring someone that people never thought about. God pulls him out and makes the person great. So right now, as you're listening to me, you're probably God's next surprise. You're probably God's next best thing that will happen. People don't know who you are, but God will pull you out of nowhere, make a great musician. God will pull you out of nowhere, bring you to the higher level. You know, I think some of us, if I can use this simple example, some of us, we know that in South Africa, most great musicians we know in South Africa, we will see them first in Joy Celebration. From Joy Celebration, they are spotted there. And from Joy Celebration, then they would go and sing. Some from Joy Celebration will go and join Spirit Music. From Spirit Music, they become great. But God surprised our nation by bringing Dr. Tumi. Who knew Dr. Tumi before Dr. Tumi recorded? Nobody knew him. There are people who are God's surprise to the world. There are people who are God's surprise to the nations of the earth. Who knows you are the next surprise in the ministry of healing? You are the next surprise in signs and wonders. You are the next surprise in miracles and deliverance. You are the next surprise in the ministry of prophecy. You are the next surprise in the anointing of prosperity. You are the next surprise in politics. You are the next surprise in music, in arts, in sports. You are the next surprise in businesses, in innovation, in science and technology. You are the next surprise in many things that God wants to do. And God is hiding you for such a time as this. If he hides you and you agree to be hidden, at the right time, he'll expose you. And nobody will question that God is working with you. Those that agree to be hidden by God, to be treasured by God, to be covered by God, when God unfolds them, nobody will question, God is working with this man. God is manifesting himself through this man. I challenge you this very day, just like David, have this type of leadership where you will wait for the right time to be elevated, to be manifested, to be revealed unto people. Even if people never thought about you, in due time, God will reveal you. I'm praying for someone right now who's looking at me right now, listening to me, right where you are, in the name of Jesus. May God hide you. May God protect you. May God cover you. May the canopy of the Lord be with you and hide you for the right time. May the enemy never be able to access you or penetrate you. The covering of the Lord will be upon you. I pray that the name of the Lord, which is a strong tower, as you hide in it, you remain safe until the right time. May God's divine protection walk with you till the day that God will release you for the world to see you. In Jesus' mighty name, I pray that it be done. Amen.